Okay. Go. All right, thank you so much for that warm welcome, Debbie, and thank you very much for everyone coming today and for those of you that are going to be watching this online later. One of the logistics things I just want to make sure everybody has first, because we are going to actually use it, we're going to do some gray matter churning today. So you need to have a copy of the handout, and if you're watching this online, there's a copy of the handout on my website. You can also get a copy of this if you go to newhorizonstrategies.com, and there's on my homepage. A blog about bringing you back to business, which is ultimately what we're going to be talking about today. So make sure you have the handout handy. All right, so let me start out with a story. I grew up in Topeka, Kansas, little six-year-old girl at one point playing on my two-acre plot of land where my parents still live in the same house I grew up in. Not exactly a farm. We did have crops and some animals there, but it was really a great place to grow up. And when I was about 6 years old, when you're kind of getting used to your body and trying to feel out all these different things that it can do, you know, I was running down our driveway. And at the time, we had a long kind of gravel driveway because we were on a 1x2 acre plot of land, so I had a pretty long driveway that I was running down. And as I'm running, as this little six-year-old, I'm thinking, you know, gosh, my body's going really fast. I didn't think it could even go this fast. How cool is that? And then I think I could go even faster. And so I'm running faster. I feel my legs really sprinting. And I wonder how many of you know how this story's going to end already. Yeah, right? Maybe I'm not the only one that has had this happen. And so all of a sudden, I realize there's this weird shift. And this part is here. And this part has maxed out. And I face plant on that fun gravel driveway, and I think I had some little pebbles to prove it for a little while after that. So my head, my ideas, my dreams, my goals, my realities, maybe at the time, got ahead of what I could actually physically do. And I use that analogously because I wonder how many times has that happened in your life, maybe when you were a six-year-old learning how fast you could actually run, but also how often is that still happening in our lives today? How often is that maybe still happening in our business? What part of our businesses is maybe getting out ahead of some other part that can't necessarily keep up with it? So that's what we're going to be focusing on is how do we make sure that we've got alignment between what I really, really want and what I'm striving for and what I can actually realistically keep up with. Many of you said this morning that time was one of the things you wish you'd had more of to do many things like networking or go on vacations or be with your family more often. You know, so that's kind of why we do this. We started our businesses because we had a dream. Maybe many of you started your businesses or are part of a different business because at some point you said, I'm tired of what I'm doing. I don't like it anymore. The world could be a different place. I could maybe achieve that transcendent purpose on Maslow's hierarchy of needs by doing something a little bit differently. And so when we start our businesses, a lot of times we start out with this very high aspirational goal. That's kind of what I did as well. When I was first graduating from Kansas State University, I got what I considered my dream job at the time. I got an opportunity to 5 days after I graduated with a bioprocess engineering degree. I'm a recovering engineer, don't worry, I can talk to people. I got an opportunity to start working on bioregenerative life support systems at the Johnson Space Center. And it was really a dream job. How do we put the Earth in a little box so we can take it somewhere else? How cool is that? You know, and a wonderful woman that had really helped me get that first job, her name was Barbara Kirkland, is Barbara Kirkland, she's still with us. She said, Lori, you're gonna love it here, but the NASA red tape and politics is gonna drive you crazy. And when I first started, kind of that little six-year-old, NASA could do no wrong, and I'm like, okay, oh my gosh, I'll keep my eyes peeled for it, thank you so much. And then about 6 years in, I started to notice a shift in the pros and the cons. It wasn't a complete shift where the cons outweighed the pros, but I started to feel like maybe what she had warned me about was starting to happen. The bureaucracy and the red tape and maybe some of the inefficiencies, I was starting to feel like I didn't really like what I was doing anymore. And I didn't take that job at NASA because I wanted to wake up every day and go, ugh, I have to go to work today. You know, nobody really wants that. So I went through a little bargaining phase and I thought, well, you know what, if I can fix the U.S. government, then it won't frustrate me anymore. And then there was this little door that opened that I also realized I had a passion for, and it won't make other people so irritated either. And maybe we'll all get along with each other. This will come back into play later in the story. So I got my Lean Six Sigma Black Belt Process Improvement Certification. A lot of you are like, oh, my son knows karate. That's not karate. It's literally more just trying to improve processes. And about 20 process improvement events in, I realized that while it seemed like I was doing something to really try to improve the government, process by process, improve the way that people could show up at work each day and actually like who they were working with and maybe like what they were doing at work, because things were just a little bit better, a little more effective. I don't think Bob's lazy. I understand he has like a million things he has to do before he can get that back to me that helps me show up at work. I realized we were only getting about 30% of what we were shooting for. And the recovering engineer / recovering perfectionist, that wasn't 100%. And I didn't understand why until I realized that it was the culture. And it was the reward system, and it was the people, and it was sometimes the processes too, but it was this more fuzzy people side of things that ultimately wasn't changing. And right at that same time, I had a significant personal tragedy in my own life. So while what we call the NASA meatball, the NASA logo, while that seemed to fall off the pedestal for me, the pedestal that I'd put it on, I also had this shattering experience in my own personal life. And I hope that you haven't had to experience anything quite like that, but I also know that it often takes a significant emotional experience, an SEE, for us to really see, for us to suddenly grow 10,000 foot tall legs and take really big strides. So similar to you, maybe in starting your own business, I realized at that point, my purpose in life is to be a positive, sustainable difference in people's lives. So that means I could have stayed at NASA, but I decided, no, I want to see the difference that I'm making a little bit more directly. I want to see it physically. I want to hear it in people's voices after I get a chance to talk to them. What was the difference that I ultimately made? So I started New Horizon Strategies, doing coaching, consulting, facilitation, and speaking to ultimately try to be that positive, sustainable difference. One of my favorite quotes is by Howard Thurman. He said, don't ask yourself what the world needs. Ask yourself what makes you come alive, and then go do it. Because that's what the world really needs, is people that have come alive. So this is why we started our businesses, or this is why we made the decision to move into the place that we're in now, because where there was struggle, now there's solution, right? But what happens, because somewhere along the way, even though I got that all figured out, gosh, sometimes I still wake up and go, ugh, I have to go to work today. What's that all about? So that's one of the things that I call the faith fear roller coaster of life. Basically, this pattern of struggle, solution, struggle, solution, struggle, solution. And it continues over and over and over again. I call it the faith fear roller coaster. That's just my terminology for it, because as we sometimes are in struggle, I tend to feel scarcity. I tend to feel these things of like, oh my God, why did I ever do this? Why did I think I could do this in the first place? I'm completely overwhelmed. How did it work out this way that I'm traveling every week? I've been in 5 hotel rooms in the last 4 weeks. Like, how did that happen? This isn't what I thought I really wanted. So sometimes that's that fear valley. But the only thing I know for sure on the faith fear roller coaster is that a faith peak is coming, that things are going to work out. Things tend to have a way of working out, don't they? And sometimes it's those significant emotional experiences. Sometimes it is that fear valley that I learn the most from. But I don't like it. I don't like to be there. I don't think I'm alone. So in that faith peak, and I don't necessarily mean religion, for one of you it may be one, or some of you it may be one and the same, but it's more of that just belief that things are going to work out. I'm doing the best that I can, and other people are too, and things are going to be okay. But sometimes it'll be the littlest thing that'll plummet me back into a fear valley, and sometimes it'll be the littlest thing that'll put me back into a faith peak. So my question for you today is, what if we could minimize how often that little thing pushes me down into a fear valley? What could we do to maybe gain a little bit more awareness of our own thoughts around what we're doing and why we're ultimately doing all this hard work so that I'm not experiencing these peaks and valleys quite so often? So that's what we're going to focus on. So on your handouts, one of the first things that I want you to consider is at the top, there's a little circle. There's a on one side and an in on the other side. And so this, from a business perspective, is a way to consider some of the things that get me stuck down into the fear valley. For me. Maybe it will for you too. I'm not sure. But I split up what I do in my business into these two categories. When I'm working in my business, I'm doing all the things I just described in my story. I am making that positive, sustainable difference in people's lives. I can see it, I can feel it. It's when I'm doing coaching, it's when I'm facilitating, it's when I'm speaking to you like I am right now. This is working in my business. This is why I started my business, to deliver these services. Or for you, maybe you have a products-based business. When you're delivering, when you're actually selling your products or your services, that's when you're working in the business. So what's this working on the business thing? And some of you have businesses that are all about helping people work on their business, but I didn't open a business to do legal stuff. Contracting. I didn't open my business to work with the IRS, as pleasant as it may be. I didn't open my business to do bookkeeping. I didn't open my business to do marketing, right? But those are the things that I have to do to be able to run an effective business. You might even say networking is one of the things I didn't necessarily open my business to do. That's working on my business as opposed to in it. I personally really enjoy networking though. You know, but that's still kind of working on versus in. So I want you to just think about what's the ratio for you. So in that circle, I want you to just draw, split that pie, however it makes sense. Is it 50% of the time I'm working on the business, 50% of the time I'm working in it? Am I working in my business more than I'm working on it? Am I working on my business more than I'm working in it? A lot of times when I first open my business, I'm working on it a lot more than I'm working in it. Maybe 75-25. And there's no right or wrong answer. I just want you to think about it because these are the things that can get in the way of maybe our head and our heart getting ahead of what our body can actually do. So two more questions. On a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being low, 10 being high, what is your average level of stress this month so far? Average level of stress, anywhere between 1 to 10. Personal and professional, everything mixed together. Average level of stress in the last month on a scale of 1 to 10. Put that X wherever you want. We're not going to share this with anybody, so no need to be too cocky nor too humble. And then the last question I want you to think about are the top three things taking the majority of your energy in your business right now. The top three things taking the majority of your energy in your business right now. And notice I said energy, not time. Actually, this book by Jim Lohr and Tony Schwartz, The Powerful Engagement, says it's not about time management, it's about energy management. So sometimes what might actually be taking the majority of my energy is that customer service call where somebody was really unhappy. And even if I was justified in what I did, it really, really, I'm ruminating over that. Like, I can't let it go.
What are the, do the same thing twice.
You can put the same thing on there twice. It's not me, right? We do business. No, I'm kidding. Okay. All right, so I want you to just kind of think about that. And as you're thinking about that, is this what you imagined? You know, back when we were in that the solution phase, I got it. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to start this business. It's going to be amazing. Or I'm going to make this change. It's going to be amazing. It's going to answer all the questions and all the struggles. Is this what you thought it would be?
Yeah.
Is this what you hoped for? Most of us might say a little bit. You know, sometimes, maybe, but not necessarily all the time. So there's another model on the back side of your handouts that I want to share that helped me. It's the New Horizon Strategies Transition Model. And the reason that I created this is because I needed something to help me understand what a touch point was, what a process or a model was that I could consider so that when things don't feel like it was exactly what I hoped for, it doesn't plummet me into the fear valley too much. So the New Horizon Strategies Transition Model is 4 stages. It's an alliteration, and it starts out with reflect, resonate, reform, and refocus. Reflect, resonate, reform, and refocus. We're really familiar with the last 2 steps, reform and refocus. As many of you commented today, more time would have been great. So as I'm trucking along, knocking things out, getting the job done, going from one place to another, trying to do everything that's on my checklist of things to do, or at least the most important ones, because there tend to be too many things on my list that I can actually do in a day anyway. When something comes up, my first reaction is, okay, how do I fix it and get back on track? What do I need to do to get back on track? And that works sometimes. But after a while, that becomes a band-aid. That becomes something that isn't actually solving the problem, maybe a systemic thing that's going on, which is why they're the first 2 stages, the reflect and the resonate stage. And actually, we've just done that this morning. We've done a reflect and a resonate stage, and that's as simple as it is. Just asking some questions like, you know, what do you wish you would have done in the last month? Or some of the questions that are on the handout. How do you feel then, the resonate stage? How do you feel about how things are going? And you may feel great. It may be fantastic, but it's just a model to help you check in and understand what am I doing and is it what I really, really want right now? Brené Brown, for those of you that might be familiar with her, she's written a couple New York Times bestsellers. Rising Strong and Daring Greatly are on the table over here. And in both of those books, she says, let our values light the way. So if I were to ask you today, do you know your values? Most of the time I get kind of this quiet, like maybe I make eye contact, maybe I kind of nod. And then I say, write them down. What are your values? If I asked you to write them down, sometimes I get the deer in the headlight look. So on my website, right next to where I put the handout for this, there's a free values assessment that you can take. So if you just go to newhorizonstrategies.com, there's a values assessment, and it's just a two gray matter churn process where you're just going to highlight words that resonate with you, values-related words that resonate with you. And then after you do that, then you're going to group them into whatever naturally makes sense to you. Quick values assessment. And the reason why we do a values assessment is because we just want to understand what direction is our compass ultimately pointing. So when I resonate, when I ask myself, is this what I really, really wanted? That's where I often get that answer back. Am I in alignment with my values? That might be why that customer service complaint really is bothering me so much, because it's not necessarily in alignment with my values. Another thing to consider as we do the reflect, resonate, reform, and refocus steps are in strategic planning. Some of you I actually just saw in putting the fun back in strategic planning course that I facilitated, or a 1-hour lecture that I facilitated. And it's meant to be funny. You know, some of you are like, I don't remember it ever being fun in the first place. But the reason sometimes why strategic planning isn't fun is because I'm so focused on the Mount Everest that I'm about to climb that it's daunting. It's overwhelming. Remember that checklist of all the things that I couldn't ever ultimately get done anyway, and maybe what I planned to do last year that I didn't actually accomplish all of them, and maybe I feel kind of bad about that? That's all still there as I'm trying to plan out all the things that I have to do to make this climb this year. So what I tell my clients is, if you're going to spend 4 hours doing strategic planning, spend half of that. Spend 2 hours looking back before you look ahead, so that you can appreciate the Mount Everest that I just spent a lot of energy, effort, and time climbing last year, and all of those little side trails that I took along the way that weren't on my goals list at the beginning of the year that actually really gave me valuable information, so that I can have that confidence in that faith that I am doing all the things that I want to be doing, whether it worked out or not. I'm proud of all the things that I've done, so that now when I look at this, it's not quite so daunting. So that's a very important step. So this is great, this is helpful, but how will you remember to actually do this? In the Power of Full Engagement here, there is a little part on rituals. And I don't know about you, but like rituals or weekly things, as much as I like to be scheduled, especially my personal time, if you tell me I have to do something on a certain day at a certain time, all of a sudden the only thing I want to do is not that. Because it became something I had to do. But in their book, they work with a lot of high performance athletes. And what they've said is even the most high performance athletes, you've got a runner who runs once a day, every day, right? And that is the ritual, very clear ritual. Even the highest performance athlete with a really clear ritual, if you tempt them three times, on average, they'll say, no, that's okay. I guess I can do something different today. So if you don't have a ritual at all in the first place, what are the chances that you're not going to do something that you really said you wanted to do? So how important is checking in and making sure that your head isn't getting ahead of your body? How important is that to you? How important is really checking in to make sure that you're doing all the things that you want to do? So what's one ritual that you might set up or bolster today? What's one thing that you might start doing, or I say bolster, because as we look back on the Mount Everest we just climbed, maybe it's just a volume knob tweak. Maybe it's just doing something I was already doing a little bit more often, like journaling or meditating, or working with a coach in my weekly coaching session, or my monthly strategy planning with my business partner or my life partner. So I'll leave you with one last tool that you might consider to put into your bucket of rituals, and that's permission slips. And we use permission slips in our work with Brené Brown's Daring Way and Rising Strong programs. And it's a way for me to do the reflect and maybe resonate step without having to specifically think about it. What do I give myself permission to do today? Maybe I give myself permission to keep working at this even though it doesn't feel in alignment with my values yet. Maybe I give myself permission to feel tired. I give myself permission to get really crazy excited about this potential opportunity that's coming up, whether or not it comes to fruition. In my coaching practice, because I'm the recovering engineering perfectionist, two of them that I have on my desk, because I do a lot of virtual coaching with folks that aren't even in Houston or the United States, is I give myself permission to not have all the answers. Because you know what, I didn't anyway. But I give myself permission to not have all the answers, to just be present with my clients, to let whatever that purpose is actually flow through and use all the amazing tools and procedures and models and books and references that I know I already have there that may or may not apply depending on what's going on with my client. And the other thing I give myself permission to do is to see the synchronicities between what was, what is, and what shall be. Because a lot of times I see that there is, maybe on that faith peak, there are all these beautiful gifts that were given all along the way if we just pay attention to them. So in closing, what will you do to remember to bring yourself back to business? What will be your touchstone? What will be the thing to make sure that you're in alignment with all the things that you really, really, really wanted in your life? Thank you.